To where if I wasn't looking at you, I would think this is one tuba player playing one really long bass line, right? So you're gonna make sure that's there. And then not getting lost in the sauce of that and saying, okay, let me dial in what the tubas are doing, but really subdividing euphoniums, your rests here so that when you come in, especially when you have to switch between the 3-4, the 3-8, you're kind of going back and forth, keeping that eighth note pulse in your brain is gonna help you a lot there. Let's just try that section. Can we start at, is 25 too weird of a place to start? Oh, that no, that's a high A flat for you. Let's not do that. Can we start at 26? Just right at 26 on these four tempos?
Do you mind if I take this down?
I don't mind at all.
Thanks.
You do you. Here, I'll catch you again. And one, two, ready. Back off the tempo just a little bit. Just to help a little bit. Where you feel a little bit more subtle, you're naturally going to take it a little bit faster in settings like this because your nerves take over. You don't want to be on the fast end of too fast. You know what I mean? No, that was the big thing there. I know that was a weird place to start you there, so don't worry about that. Third movement really is just about alignment for me. It can be as simple as, I mentioned this to another one of your groups, of taking four measure chunks and just kind of bopping your entrances a little bit, particularly if you have sustained pitches, any of these forzando sections, to really get that bell tone to hear the front and hear what it would sound like if there's nothing on the tail end, which brings me to my big point here with articulations and the dynamic markings that you have. Any sforzando that you have, or sforzando piano, you've got to get that front of the note there, which you're doing, and immediately go away, right? It's got to almost disappear. I know, I wish, I get that sforzandos and forte pianos are different things. I just wish they would write a forte piano, because it's clearer for us to picture what they're wanting, which is that, I think. It's in the first movement. That's my only comment for the first movement, was the sforzandos that you have at 8, right? Get away from that note so we can hear this running 16th note line that moves forward, right? And you've got the sforzando pianos there in the third movement. So those are the like kind of big, broad picture things. I'm going to say something about the second movement that's going to sound like an insult, and I don't want it to sound like an insult. So don't take it that way, hopefully, okay? You four play so well and play too well to play that movement as expressively and phrase-wise boring as we played it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It was notes and rhythm-wise, you got it, right? But I think we were thinking about the notes and rhythms is what it sounded like to me, okay? And that's not necessarily to say you didn't play it. That just means that, like, okay, go back and work on the musicality of that. And for all I know, again, I get a snapshot of what you worked on. You might have, and then here we are at, 8:27 at night, and you're like, I've been waiting for this all day, and I can't even think about music anymore. That's fine, right? Think more, again, take more risks. Kind of like Romanium, kind of like, whatever else you play tonight. Take risks dynamically in this with the pushing and pulling. Give ideas to each other. Try them, even if they're bad. Okay? That would be my suggestion. And play, I've said this for other groups too, but play from the score for this movie. So you can see how the line is moving and how it's moving around you when you're just kind of like sitting on your football of a note, right, for a while. See how the line is moving. See how you can enhance that by maybe crescendoing underneath tuba players, right, or euphonium players, how you can, trade off lines with one another. Be creative with that, because the four of you clearly are very